I love my city, but the reality of it is that there are so many stories that need to be told, including mine. And I think now is the time to finally tell it the way that I know how. And this is a start to me. I gave you love, you know, what children are supposed to have, love, you know, I got a nice home to live in. I enjoyed every minute of taking care of my three children. I enjoyed it, you know, but some obstacles came into my life. If life goes on, you know, I realized my mistakes I made in life, you know what I'm saying? You know, my addiction went, you know, doing those drugs. Yeah, I had a lot of drug problems, smoking old crack.
I noticed that there was a dish plate right by the tub on the floor, and it had a face cloth over it, and I had lifted it up because I figured it was kind of odd to find a dish plate in the bathroom. And sure enough, there was white, like a white powder substance and a razor blade. I was kind of stunned. At that time, I'm like, I know what that is. That's drugs. That's literally cocaine. I froze, you know, and I put the face cloth or the towel, I put the towel back over the plate. I never mentioned it to anyone, and I kept it to myself. But from that point on, I knew that my mom was on drugs, and it explained her behavior in her absence in our life at the time, where she would come home probably every other day. She would come home and she would be either drunk or too tired. And sometimes we would miss school because she wouldn't come home at sometimes. Like, she would be gone for 2 or 3 days at a time. And it became bad where she would be gone a week at a time. And my grandmother and my aunt, they had to move in because they had to watch us. Because my dad was working, he was a provider, and no one was able to watch us.
My cousin introduced me to that. And what happened, I was going to school. I used to go to North Adams State College. And my first love, you know, I used to come on the weekends, and he hurt my heart, which, you know, when he came up, he got another girl pregnant. And that's my first love, so my heart got broken. So I was telling my cousin about these issues that I had, and the issues that I had, and next thing she know, she said, well, I got something to make you feel better, and she introduced me to crack cocaine. And that's how my addiction started, with crack. Introduced, you know, for me attending to my schooling, and so that's what led me to using. I smoke it. I never shot any drugs in my life, never intervened any drugs. I used to smoke it. Never shot any drugs. I used to probably sniff a little bit. What I had on my mind, you know, it took away that pain, but then it still came back to reality. So I, you know what, I just go on because I know, I look at reality for what reality is. I know that's not gonna solve the problem, regardless of a male involved in it or whoever. I have to take on my feelings with life terms. Don't let nobody get involved in my life. I never, you know what I'm saying, stole, took anything from my children or stole anything from my family. I never, you know, got to that point that I did that. But I always took care of my children. That's why I said that's what made me late to using drugs. So I have to just go on with life and deal with life as life is. DSS came to my house. They misinterpreted things. They thought I was not taking care of my children, which was not true. That's made me lead to another heartbreak in my life. Father took over the situation, and then, like I said, I was feeling so hurt again, so that's why I continued doing the things I was doing in life over and over again, repeated it as I was losing something that was belonging to me. What I should have had shown them that my mother was living there, but I didn't bring up my mother at the time. You know, they had one of those prejudiced social worker, that's what it was. She assuming, quote assuming, when she came into the home, there was food there, nice apartment there, everything was, you know, as you know how it's supposed to be as a child, as a mother raising their children. I was numbing myself. You see what I'm saying? That was beginning my use, using drugs, numbing myself. I'm doing better now. You know what I'm saying? I'm not interacting. I'm not, that lifestyle is not in my life anymore.
I had to grow up pretty fast, I realized. I knew what was happening towards the end, before before social services came knocking at our door. One night, social services came. These two white women showed up at our apartment. I was outside and I came in and I realized that they were inside our apartment. I'm like, who are these white women in our apartment? Like, what's going on? My dad said that, they're here to take you and your sister away, so you guys should start packing because you're going over your aunt's house, his sister's house. You know, we grew up in the city. We grew up in Mattapan, you know, in Boston, and we're used to the city and, you know, the urban parts of the city especially. So certain parts of the neighborhood were rough, but we went from that to moving to the suburbs, which was really new to us, you know? Like, we weren't used to seeing a lot of white people. Or, you know, in that fashion, we weren't used to seeing, you know, one family homes and green grass and lawns and all that stuff. So it was different. We were leaving our friends behind. We were leaving everything we knew behind. And it was really, really hard. Once I had to go, my dad told me to go look for my sister because she wasn't in that, in the house. And, I got her and I told her what was going on, and she was confused, and I said, we have to pack as much as we can. And because at that point, they were literally going to take us into social service custody. So my dad said, no, like, they're going to stay with my sister. They're not going to foster care. And so he called his sister, my aunt, and told her what was happening. That was that. We said our goodbyes that night to a couple of our friends, including my very good friend, Sharira, who I look at as my cousin. That was the hardest part because we hung out every single day. But yeah, we stayed with my aunt and my uncle for 2 years until they realized that my father wasn't, I guess, doing what he was supposed to do in regard to getting custody of us and getting us a home. Because at this time, we lost the apartment. You know, so my aunt and grandmother ended up, I'm not sure if they moved into a shelter. I think they were in a shelter for a little bit, and then they found an apartment. Everything was great. Like, we enjoyed living with our aunt and uncle and our two cousins, and it was great until we realized that they couldn't do it anymore. They couldn't take care of my sister and I. We ended up going to court the day before we entered foster care. We said our goodbyes. My sister and I said our goodbyes to my father, my aunt, and my uncle. And our social worker, she was an awesome lady. Super cool. She drove us to our foster home. And we were super nervous. We're like, we're about to live with a stranger. And we don't know who this person is, what they look like, anything. But we were still, you know, pretty upset, and, you know, we were recovering from crying and all that stuff, so we were really exhausted. We were supposed to stay with her for, I believe it was 6 months. It ended up being 4 years that we were in foster care. So every 6 months, we were told, you know, you're going to go back with your dad, you're going to see your family again. And it just, we just gave up hope. We were like, we're going to probably age out of the foster care system at this point. I wasn't referred to as Angelica to some of the kids in high school as a freshman. I was referred to foster sister. Hey, aren't you so-and-so foster sister or whatever, or sister? And that was a little embarrassing because that wasn't who I was as an individual. I would like to have been known as Angelica and, you know, stand alone. But unfortunately, he was popular. A lot of people liked him, and I was shy and quiet and reserved to myself. So I wasn't as outgoing, but no one messed with me because it was popular. And so that was cool. And, he had my back. And that's one thing I did appreciate.
So I should have reported her twice because the first event that happened was when I came home late from school, and I basically stayed after school, and I took the late bus home, and I guess it was nighttime. I came home really late. And soon as I hit the corner, girl, she came out that corner and thought it fucking me up, Angelica. Like, this balled up, like, swinging, hitting my face, hitting it, like, just swings hitting everywhere, basically. And it happened so fast. And mind you, there were people outside that witnessed all of this. Like, the people that would hang outside next door across the street witnessed everything. And it was so embarrassing. She literally came outside and two-pieced me, gave me a couple two-pieces, because I came home late after school, and I didn't call her to let her know, because I was always so scared to even ask her anything. Like, it just was so uncomfortable to even ask her anything, or just to even tell her something, you know what I mean? So, that was the first thing that she did. The second event was the time I was shoplifting in H&M. Went inside H&M. I had no money because every time we got a fucking check, she kept it. We never had money in our pocket. So I decided to five-finger discount and didn't think of the consequences because, of course, I was young. I didn't know. So I'm just there stealing. Next thing you know, I got caught. And then, I had to go to the back, of course. And then comes, and she comes to the back, and again starts to fuck me up, like two-piecing me in front of everybody. And I had to literally hold my arm up, like, to, like, protect myself, cover my face, because she was, like, really going ham, pow, 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 with her fist. And then as we're leaving, we're in the car, she's like, you ain't gonna be shit. You know, you're just like your mother. Blah, 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 blah. Why are you stealing? And it went that way.
I became frustrated with my social worker, who wasn't anymore. We had a new social worker. I became frustrated with my therapist because I felt like she was just fuckless. Like, she didn't really care. When I expressed to her that I was physically assaulted, she didn't really do much about it. It was kind of like, I said, I want to file a 51A on her, on my foster mother, for what she did to me. She literally yoked me up like this. I was crying, hysterical, like confused. Like, why would you do this to me? Like,
after school, we usually go to Alway Station. But instead of going to Alway Station, we detoured and went to David Square Station, I believe. And I think we ended up doing that because they told us we couldn't go to Alway. So we went to Davis Square Station, which took us longer than usual to get home from school. So when we got home from school, came home and she was upset, angry that we got home late. She's like, oh, well, why you guys come home so late? Blah, 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 blah. Where were you guys? And basically we were trying to explain to her that we had to go to Davis Square Station and not Alewife. And blah, 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 blah. So she didn't want to hear our side of the story, basically. She was just upset at the fact that we came home late after school. And she was just so furious, she blacked out. Really, honestly, she didn't want to hear our explanation of why anyway. So she took it upon herself to just get angry and put hands on you. And that just was not the way to go. So, and the part I was upset about, Angelica, was when we reported it to... And basically nothing was done about it. Absolutely nothing.
I filed a 51A against her.
Because we told about
it. I struggle to remember exactly why she put her hands around my throat.
Yeah, and she took it upon you because you were the oldest one. And yeah,
right.
You know, basically... You know,
it happened so fast because she stormed in the room.
Exactly. It happened so
She stormed
fast
in the room.
That she didn't even want to hear
She barely, anything. She still had her work uniform on and everything.
Oh, right.
I remember that.
Navy blue slacks with the light blue running down.
Like, I'm not responsible for your kids. You are. We're kids ourselves. You know what I mean? Like, legally, we're not responsible for your kids. You are, you know, so it was kind of like, why am I being punished, you know, for looking after your kids and having a slip up? We're kids ourselves. Shit happens. We're taking the public transportation. You know, I had a journal and I would write in that journal and I would express my anger and my confusion and I would just write all my feelings out. And it was really therapeutic. It was more therapeutic than going to therapy. If you can you imagine that? I started to develop a strong dislike for my foster mother at the time. I almost ran away, literally. I ended up talking to this guy online. He lived in North Carolina at the time. He was much older than I was. And I just wanted a getaway. I didn't even care I was leaving my sister behind. I just felt so tired and exhausted.
Entertainment was what saved me from being depressed, you know, for every fucking day. Every day. If it wasn't for my sister and I keeping each other's spirits up and going while in foster care and dreaming and hoping that, you know, we will persevere, we will get out of this okay, you know? We will not be another statistic.
I found myself having random attitudes with my mom, and I don't want to. But I think I just... I'm trying to find a connection as a grown woman now with my mom, because it's so different having a connection with your mother as a kid. So I'm trying to find that balance, and it's hard. And I want to forgive her for what she, you know, for what she did to us. Because she loved us, you know? Like, I know she was sick, and it took me a while to realize that, but I never stopped loving her while we were in foster care. I just wanted to see her. And the day that we finally seen her after 4 years of being in foster care, we seen her in the hospital because I think my dad was in the hospital for something and she showed up and she was skinny. I've never seen my mom skinny, ever. And we knew it was, you know, due to drugs and... It was like not seeing your, like you go from having the best of everything to not seeing your mother for years. And I wanted to see my mommy. I literally just kind of felt like she failed us and left us to a pack of wolves, also known as the system. We would have to come home straight after school. We didn't participate in any after school programs. We didn't really go to any parties. I remember going to like maybe two parties the entire time that we lived with. One was a school party and I believe another was a house party, and that had to be with her son. So if I did anything, it would have to be with her son. I couldn't do anything on my own with my friends, so he would have to like be around for me to like do majority of things. And for some reason she didn't really trust me much, and I, to an extent, I didn't blame her. I almost ran away. So she found out that I was planning on running away because the guy I was talking to in North Carolina had mailed me my plane ticket, and she opened up my mail and she seen the confirmation, you know, ticket and all that stuff, and she seen the address of where it came from, and she's like, North Carolina, who's this guy? And she confronted me about it, and she actually told my aunt and uncle and my dad about it, and they all had this little meeting, and they had to monitor me for like a little bit until I gained their trust back. But they never cared to find out why I tried to run away. Like, it was just kind of like I said, punishment after punishment. Like, oh, you do something bad, punishment. As opposed to figuring out why you did something bad, you know? And I felt like maybe if they actually cared to figure out how we were feeling, my sister and I wouldn't have done half of the stupid shit that I did. I wouldn't have lost my virginity. If I was able to talk to someone other than my sister, I wouldn't have tried to run away if I didn't feel like I had to. I didn't want to leave my sister behind. I didn't. But I felt like I felt like the world was on my shoulders and I just wanted to get away. So I kept thinking of Hollywood, LA. Like, I was like, when I get out of foster care, like, when I turn 18, that's it. I'm out.
So this door doesn't have a buzzer. You have to have keys to get in this side. And I remember as kids, we didn't have keys really. So We had to used to like get buzzed in by our parents. A lot of memories over here. And we used to chill over here on the staircase.
Yeah. And then it moved inside.
And everybody had an attitude because we used to be in the way.
My name is Sharera. I'm one of Angelica's closest friends. We've met here in this, actually in the same place, a long time ago. I don't know how many years, but it's been a very long time, and we've been close ever since.
I lived on 60 Hazleton Street, and she lived on
70
Hazleton Street, which is right behind the camera. Coming back here just brings a lot of memories because we both had a lot in common, and Sharera had her story to share and I had mine. We've known each other for 10 years while we were living here, and we're still friends, which is really great. So she knew my sister, Trina, who's now transgender. Eventually, over time, you know, a lot has happened. You know, we've lost people. It's still nice to come back here. There are probably a couple of people that still live here, at least in my building. You don't know anyone that lives in your building still, right?
I don't know.
I remember the day that I left here.
And I don't even know if I was here when it happened.
I
heard about it.
Yeah, so unfortunately my sister and I, we ended up having to move with my aunt, who lived about 20 minutes from here. In the suburbs, we were supposed to go in foster care literally like a couple of days after social services came. Mm-hmm. And you know, I felt like it happened so fast, and I didn't even get to say bye to her, so that was pretty sad. But
I was devastated when I heard the whole thing went down.
Yeah.
I knew the scenario pretty well because the same thing happened to me. So.
Yeah, unfortunately.
They always say things happen for a reason, and I was really, I was happy that I met Angelica, because it was hard for me it still is. It was hard to make friends as it was back then, and I just happened to be in the right place in the right time, which was outside on the parking lot right there.
Like the early 2000s.
Yeah.
That was such a great time, though, because, the memories, you know, mm-hmm. from the music to the barbecues in the backyards, you know, mm-hmm. the teeny juices, the firecrackers. I can still smell the hot dogs grilling. You know what I mean?
That.
I can still hear Mary J. Blige playing Real Love in the background.
Oh, man.
You know what I mean?
Like, I remember 3LW.
3LW, yeah. Like, that was our time, you know? Like, and to not have that anymore, it sucks. We're adults now. We got to do adult shit.
Mm-hmm.
You
sure
know?
Do.
And it's hard. But, you know, through all of it, we're still here. You know what I mean? In the same place that we grew up in.
Mm-hmm.
And it's so quiet now.
It is.
It's so quiet. No,
there's
over
not
here.
Really any kids out here anymore.
Yeah.
But back then, this
it was
place,
filled with kids.
So
playing
many
outside.
Kids. Playing outside, yelling,
aren't
screaming.
Playing outside no more. You know, everybody's inside playing their video games on the internet, on the phone. Social media is taking over. So kids aren't playing outside like they used to. And that was.
I'm glad
that
I
was
had the childhood when I did.
People can't relate to anymore.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so. Damn. I'm glad to be, you know, where I'm at. Compared to where I came from,
mm-hmm.
and you know what happened from the time leaving here up until now, so to be bad, oh my God!
But we only bad
we were good kids, but we were only bad to the adults that messed with us, you know.
Pretty like, much,
basically, because we were cool, we're innocent, we mind our business, you know.
It was pretty much like. Adults who thought that they were kids still, like
yeah, immature
they thought
adults.
They pretty much, yeah,
and thought they could match with us, which was weird.
I don't
when
know.
You think about
it was
it.
An awkward
I
time.
I was like, how old? Like 12, 13, or something like that. I was like 13. We used to like knock over trash cans and like ring people's doorbells and run.
Do you remember that time when Raphael was here and they threw Bonus grill in the middle of the street and the car ran
God.
Over it? I forgot all about that until right now.
We used
right
to
now.
Put things in the middle of the road just to see, like,
what
people
cars.
Would do. Like, if they would get out and move it, or they would go around it, you know. Like, some people would just knock it over, you know. And we used to hear these loud boom sounds, you know. And I was just like, we are so bad.
It wasn't anything to, like, damage the car.
Yeah, it was like, you know, like a plastic, like,
not
trash.
At all.
Can or something like that,
or
you know,
a cone.
Like a cone, yeah, it
yeah,
was a cone,
and then we
like nothing like metal, you know,
yeah.
that would damage your car.
And now that I think about it, I'm like,
and I remember one guy got out the car and came over.
No, because
one
we
night.
Threw snowballs and oh. two of them hit the windshield, and then we ran.
We heard him yelling at the
and,
top of his
and
lungs.
You said, "Don't run in the house because they'll know we live there." So we ran up behind the building. Because it was Chanel, she threw it. It's like, boom. We were gone, man. There was so many of us.
And this kid named Daryl, he put red ants on my back.
I wasn't
and
there
I
for that.
And I remember my mom had to pluck, like, we were so bad. Oh, my God. She had to take the bands off one by one because they were pinching my skin. But yeah, we had so many memories. Like, oh my God.
That was so funny.
And we're still making them. Yeah. Still making more memories together.
That's what life's about.
It was nice growing up, and sometimes we had our ups and downs. Sometimes there was problems in the house, but, you know, we got through those problems, and things was kind of getting tough at the end as we was growing up, but things were really, like, kind of depressing as we got older because, you know, our mother started using drugs and started, you know, going on a downfall. We didn't even really notice she was using until, like, my stepfather was, like, going on about it. Like, oh, you never hear, you never cook, you never do anything, and why are you always out and never come home? But otherwise, my mother was always a nice lady, you know. I never had no problems with growing up with her. Like, she always kept food on the table. She always, like, she was like the neighborhood family person. Like, everybody came to her for advice. Everybody came to her if we had junk food. Everybody came to her if they needed some, until she started hanging out with certain people. Like,
we used to play Mario Kart and, like,
Mario Party.
And we was a beast, you know? And I, like, my apartment was, like, the place to go for, like, the kids in the neighborhood, because that's where we played our video games.
That's where all the snacks were.
Yeah, we had all the snacks in the neighborhood. And, like, everybody used to, like, come over and take all the stuff. And, you know, my parents allowed it, you know, but after a while they...
It was getting a little bit out of hand.
Really, really bad, so...
We was lost for words. We didn't know what she was doing until, like, people was figuring out that she didn't have her hair done. People kept questioning me, like, oh, what's wrong with your mother? What's wrong with your mother? I couldn't figure it out. I just thought it was a normal thing that she just didn't do her hair and she just forgot it was being lazy. It just was like a ongoing thing about it. I started doing bad things like myself. I met this guy named Rick at the age of 14. Rick was like 24, I was like 14. Things was getting tough because, like, he was homeless, and at one point I was like, fuck it, I'm just gonna run with him. And I just ran with him, and whenever he was homeless, I ran with him and I didn't care. And it was just really tough for me because they were young, so they didn't know what's going on, and I just couldn't live my life. I was living like a shithole. Like, it was a tough road that I had to live. I even had to run away. I didn't have nowhere to go. I was living on the streets, and it was a tough time. And I remember one point, you know, I met up with my sister in DSS, and I was, you know, asking for their number. Like, they gave me their number, and then I got put in DSS, and next thing you know, I was living on Calendar Street. It was, like, right near the projects, and Dorchester was right near the projects, and I used to dress up like a girl and sneak out the house and do stupid stuff, and next thing you know, I'm kicked out of that house because I was dressed like a girl. And it was, like, really tough for me. I was just living on the streets. Living on the streets, didn't have nowhere to go.
While we were in foster care, Trina had transitioned. She went from Joshua to Trina, legally. She changed her name, and then she got a boob job, and then she, you know, started taking hormones and everything, and it was kind of like it was so fast. And that's the thing, is I thought she was just a feminine gay guy, you know, and that was it. I didn't know that she wanted to be a woman. Or felt like a woman, so to speak. But she transitioned, and it took a while for me to call her Trina, and refer to the pronouns of her and she as opposed to he and him and Joshua, because that's what I was used to. That's what I, you know, that's what we were used to, the family. We were all used to calling Trina Joshua, even though Trina had boobs and everything and, you know, wore makeup, I would still say Joshua. I was almost like losing a sibling to me at the time. And then, you know, I started worrying because I knew that I knew that it was going to be hard for Trina. And I knew that, you know, people would be mean. And I worried. Like, I had to worry about so much at a young age. And I don't think people realize that. Like, I had to worry about myself. I had to worry about my sister, Chanel. I had to worry about, you know, Trina. Like, if she's okay. And at the time, like, we haven't had contact with our mother most of the duration of we were in foster care. We didn't know where our mother was. We had no clue. We didn't know if she was alive. Like, we didn't know. No one told us where she was. Like, you know, like here and there, we might have, like towards the end of us being in foster care, we would hear that, you know, oh, we've seen her over here. We've seen her, you know, on this corner or whatever. And I'm like, how does everyone else get to see our own mother and we can't? You know, like, how am I jealous that people in our family get to see her, get to see her mother? Like, I didn't understand, like, I thought it was so unfair that everybody was telling me about my mother and I couldn't even see her. And I blamed myself. I blamed myself for being where we were. You know, like, I had to take a certain role that I didn't want to take and I wasn't ready for. Like, I was really protective of my sister, and I think we became really close while we were in foster care because we had to look out for each other. Because it seemed like nobody else would.
Reunited with my grandmother, reunited with my mother and everything. And then next thing you know, I'm in a care where people was noticing that I was getting healthy. I thought I was just having fun, just being me. They thought I was just doing stupidity things and I couldn't do this, I couldn't do that. I felt like I was being a child. Now I'm in a program called and I feel like I still can't do anything. I'm in this program now. Hopefully I see myself, you know, in a better state of mind, in a better home, independent, living on my own, living happily, and just living freely.
I had dreams. I had a lot of dreams that I had expressed, you know, to my foster siblings and I'm sure to my foster mom. I said, I'm going to go to California. I'm going to move to LA. At the time, I was obsessed with the hills and Laguna Beach because it came out during that time. So I was obsessed with Lauren Conrad, LC. And I wanted to be like her. I loved her style. I see me in her. And I was like, I want to go to fashion school. I want to go to FIDM. But at the time, my foster mom didn't want us to leave. She wanted to actually adopt us and keep us until we were 18. But we didn't want that. And neither did my dad, of course. We ended up moving in and to my dad's house along with his girlfriend at the time. Decided to major in entertainment management. I grew fascinated with the idea of working in film and media. That's something that I really thought I knew what I wanted, and I did. I graduated I got my associate's and I graduated with 2.7, which is pretty decent for the fact that I was this lost soul in college and I was just doing what I thought I was supposed to do and I was trying to prove people wrong and even prove myself wrong that I can do whatever the fuck I want and no one's going to tell me different. And so that happened and I literally, I grabbed the internship at 7 News, NBC, and productions. You know, I started picking up things. I was becoming independent. I was still living at my aunt's house at the time while I was in college at Bay State. And I was like, you know, once I turned 21, that's when I got my own apartment. Working in film at the time, so that's how I was supporting myself as a producer assistant. And I started to hate the job. I hated the long hours and I hated... The money was okay, but I felt like I could have made more given the fact that I had a degree and experience. So I quit.
My nephew, Aiden, was born March 30th, 2017, and he is the light of our family. My sister, Chanel, gave birth, and watching her being pregnant and growing her first child was really beautiful to witness. As an older sister, you know, it was really cool because I'm like, I've never gave birth to a child. So to see that her belly being big and growing, it was really amazing to witness. And I was so happy for her after seeing how strong she is, you know. It was great to witness and seeing how motherhood has shaped her to be this phenomenal woman is really inspiring because it shows me the endurance of everything she's been through as a child in her teen years and all the struggles that we both had to face at a young age, and seeing her become this individual human being giving my nephew a great start in life. You know, my nephew will be protected. He will have everything that he needs. He will never have to go through trauma and face the same issues that we had to face as kids and in our teen years. And I want to make sure of that. As an aunt, he is my priority. And I want to make sure that he is able to travel the world. I want to make sure that he is able to have a great education and have a great career and find his passion. And I want us to be able to let him be a child. I want to let us make sure that he is able to grow and be the best version of himself with the support around him. And he is such an awesome kid. He's now 3 years old. And I enjoy seeing him progress into being a young boy. And I look forward to seeing him progress into being a young man. And I will make sure that he is not a misogynistic asshole. I will make sure that he's not transphobic, homophobic. I will make sure that he has great communication skills. My family today is what I have, and it's all I have. Through the good and the bad, you know, through the drama and the laughter. And I would not trade any of that because I'm content with where I am now in life. I was able to see 37 countries. I was able to travel the world. I was able to have a career from my struggles because I was so determined to be where I wanted to be. When I would be in my bedroom when I was in foster care and just dream and hope and envision myself being a content creator, being a videographer, film director, producer, photographer. I wanted to be the best version of my adult self, and I wish that I was able to tell my younger version, hey, it's going to be okay. You're going to make it out, and you're going to have an amazing life waiting for you. You were able to summit Mount Kilimanjaro. You were able to trek all the way to Mount Everest base camp.
You guys, because it took me so much energy and determination to get here, and I made it, and I'm happy because I put another woman of color on the map here at Mount Everest Base Camp, especially an African-American woman. I'm just happy.
You were able to travel to 37 countries within 5 years and visit multiple of those countries within those 5 years. I was able to meet amazing people along the way. I was able to love. I was able to give. I was taken advantage of, but I learned from my mistakes and what I contributed to those relationships that ended badly. And I learned my lessons to be a better person. And I learned to care. You know, I'm now 28 years old. I'm college educated. I have a certificate degree in filmmaking. And I'm now a screenwriter. I was able to work on this project alone, and now I want to share my story with the world. You know, that is what matters to me. You know, I enjoy our family moments in the kitchen. I enjoy our family moments when we're having dinner at restaurants and having phone conversations and FaceTime and, you know, looking at family photos and reminiscing about all the good times that we had together and the bad. And it really shaped me to be someone who's giving. I'm now someone that embraces womanhood and understands exactly what I want as a woman. And I don't tolerate bullshit anymore. I now know how to say no with my chest. I now know how to speak up about things that I don't like, about things that I don't want, and not give a crap about what anyone else has to say about it. I am a strong Black American woman, and I survived. I survived, and I will continue to support and help those, whether it's my family or a stranger, to be the best version of themselves through the most chaotic and confusing times of their lives. That's my purpose. We're going to be somebody. Right? We're going to do whatever the fuck we want to do. And I did, you know? Again, I'm 28 years old now, and I'm living. I'm actually finally living.